ينزلونه من المنبر ويقول مثلك لا يخطب، يعني الذي تستحي منه الملائكة رضي الله عنه وأرضاه، ويقتلونه ويطعنونه ويذبحونه رضي الله عنه وأرضاه، أين عقولهم؟ ولذلك البدع والأهواء تشغف الإنسان فتجعله كالمجنون. جاء في الحديث قال كما جاء في الحديث في يعني تعرض الفتن على القلوب كعرض الحصير عودا عودا، فأيما قلب أشربها نكتت فيه نكتة سوداء، وأي قلب أنكرها نكتت فيه نكتة بيضاء، حتى تصير القلوب على قلبين. قلب أبيض لا تضره فتنة ما دامت السماوات والأرض، وقلب أسود، وذاك وصف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بأنه كالصفا. الصفا يعني الحجار الملساء، لو وضعت عليها شيئا فإنها تسيل وتذهب. وأما القلب الأسود فإنه كالكوز مجخيا، يعني كأس، والكأس هذا هكذا يعني مقلوب، هل تستطيع تضع فيه شيء؟ ما تستطيع، كالكوز مجخيا، لا يعرف معروفا ولا ينكر منكرا إلا ما أشرب من هواه، إلا ما أشرب من هواه. هكذا أهل بدع، أهل أهواء، أهل أهواء. ولذلك كان أهل السنة ولله الحمد هم أعقل الناس، ينظرون إلى ما جاء عن الله، ما جاء به، ما جاء عن الله وما جاء به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وما فهمه الصحابة رضي الله عنهم، فإذا بهم الصحابة هم أعقل الناس وهم رضي الله عنهم وأرضاهم. ولذلك كان أهل السنة هم الذين حظوا بهذا الشرف العظيم، وهو الاتباع للصحابة الكرام رضي الله عنهم وأرضاهم. نعم.
And if we look, we find in the Quran many examples that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. And most of those examples are examples that one could understand by way of having a sound mind and a sound intellect, by way of pondering and thinking about them. And those are examples for the people to understand, to ponder upon them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after mentioning the people of polytheism and that their example is like the example of a spider that took a house, and that the weakest of all houses is the house of spiders. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the meaning of the verse, and those examples, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions them, and no one understands them except those who are wise, and those who have sound minds and sound intellects. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala...
إِلَّا الْعَالِمُونَ. نعم. ولذلك كان بعض السلف يقول لست من العالمين، إذا مر على مثال لا يفهمه لست من العالمين.
جزاكم الله خير. عشان حفظه الله.
وهم خطأ من.
جزاكم الله. عشان حفظه الله. He said that no one knows them except those who are knowledgeable. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and some of the salaf, when they pass by examples and they do not understand them, they would say, "I'm not a knowledgeable person," because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that no one understands those examples except those who are knowledgeable. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions many examples in the Quran, and those examples, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions them so that we ponder upon them, and we seek to understand them, and to think about them. And the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the religion in general does not come with anything that the intellects find to be impossible. But rather, it comes with things that the intellects find amazing. And there is a difference between the two. The things that are impossible, that the intellects would say it is absolutely impossible and there is no way that this could be, then those are things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not address the people with. And does not, those are not things that we find in the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions things that the intellects find amazing. The sound intellects find and consider to be amazing. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the people with that which they can understand. And this is something that we need to understand. Know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He was to address the people and mention to the people things that they can never understand and comprehend, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is not possible, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have been unjust to the people by commanding them to ponder upon the Quran while they cannot understand the Quran. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have oppressed them, and that is not possible. Because the only way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, do they not ponder, in the meaning of the verse, do they not ponder upon the Qur'an? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to ponder upon the Qur'an. So the Qur'an must be understandable to us. And we must be able to understand the Qur'an. And therefore the people, the Salaf, rahimahullah, they refuted the people of innovation. Those who claim that the Qur'an has things that cannot be understood. Absolutely cannot be understood. And that there are things that are apparent from the Qur'an and things that are hidden, that the people cannot know and cannot understand. And that is not the case. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Qur'an, in the meaning of the verse, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent it down with a clear Arabic tongue. So it is, the Qur'an is clear for those who ponder and think and understand. And in reality, claiming that the Qur'an has things that are not, things that people cannot understand and are not understandable by any of the people, then this is an accusation against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a refutation, and this is also an evidence, a clear evidence. It is a refutation to those who make this claim, and it is a clear evidence that the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are understandable. We know the meanings of the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not how. We don't know how are the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we know their meanings. As for how they are, then this is not possible for us to come to know. As for the meanings, then they are known. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam affirmed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He affirmed to Himself, that He has hands, and He has a face, and He has a foot, and He comes, and He descends, and so on and so forth. All of those are things that a person can understand. One can understand their meanings, not how they are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to ponder upon His verses, and in His verses He affirmed to Himself these things. And therefore it is upon us to know and understand and affirm them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that befits Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for this reason, the people of Sunnah are the most wise from amongst the people. Ahlul Sunnah are the most wise of all of the people, because they do not go against the texts from the Quran and the Sunnah. Shaykh Usama ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah.
لأن البدعة يا إخوة البدعة مفسدة للعقول كما أن الشرك مفسد للعقول.
This is because the innovations, they corrupt the intellects, just like polytheism corrupts the intellects. Shaykh Usama ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said, being like and similar to the Sahaba, to the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and their followers, it increases one with strong and sound mind, and also in religion and good manners. So it is upon us to look at the people of the companions, may Allah be pleased with them. What did they do? How did they treat one another? How? What were they upon? And to follow them. And by way of that, one becomes from the most wise of people. Ahl al-Sunnah wa Jama'ah, the most wise. They are the most wise in regards to singling out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and following the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whereas the people of innovation are like fools and are like madmen. Look at the people of revolutions, and other than that, look at them. They are like mad people. They are like people who are mentally ill. As for the person of Sunnah, he is wise. He has a sound mind. He looks at the benefits and the harms, and he looks at the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah, he said, when the trial and the tribulation comes down, or when the trial and tribulation rather comes, then the scholars know it. And as for when it leaves, is when the general people come to know it. They come to know that this was a trial. Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah, they hold on to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is from the reasons, or this is the main reason that they are that they have sound minds. And Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, he said regarding al-Sufiyya, the Sufis, he said no one goes with them in the beginning of the day, except that by noon he will become like a fool man or like a madman. And likewise he said whomsoever goes with them and spends time with them for 40 days, or no one, he said no one goes with them for 40 days and remains with sound mind. This is the way of the people of innovation, people of falsehood, that they have no sound minds, and rather they are like fool people, and they are like madmen. They do things that even animals would not do. Even animals would stay away from. Also look at the Khawarij. As Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahmahullah, he said, they did not defend their religion, nor did they harm the enemies of the religion. But rather they only harm the Muslims and the Muslim countries, and they make them weaker. From the time that they went against the people of Sunnah and against the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, until our date. That they only kill, they go and fight against the Muslims, and they kill them, and they leave the people of idols. Look at them, how they killed Uthman radiallahu anhu, the one whom the angels are shy of. The angels, they are shy of Uthman because of his shyness. The companion of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they went to kill him, and on their way, they passed by some disbelievers. And they said, those are the ones the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to protect. And they're while on their way to kill Uthman radiallahu anhu. And they make him come down from the minbar, prevent him from giving khutab. And other than this, from their evil. And then they killed him, and they slaughtered him radiallahu anhu. And this is all from their foolishness. So the innovations and the desires, they make the person like a madman. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that the trials and the tribulations, they come upon the hearts. And every heart that accepts it, there will be a doubt on that heart. And every heart that rejects it, that doubt will be removed, and the heart will be cleansed, until the hearts become one of two. Either a heart that is white and clean, and it is not never harmed by any trial, as long as the heavens and the earth never cease or do not cease. And a heart that is like an upside down cup. It does not accept anything that is good, and it does not reject anything that is evil, unless it comes in agreement with its desires. Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah are the most wise, because they take the Qur'an and the Sunnah, and they follow the Qur'an and the Sunnah based upon the understanding of the most wise of the people, the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is something that we should receive as a glad tiding.
ولذلك ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما لما ذهب يناظر الخوارج قالوا له من أين جئت يا ابن عباس؟ قال جئتكم من عند أصحاب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم رضي الله عنهم. نزل القرآن فيهم وهم أعلم بتأويله، هم أعلم بتأويله، لأنه هم الذين عاصروا نزول القرآن وعرفوا في من نزل وكيف نزل وما هو سبب نزوله، فالأعلم بالقرآن أعلم بالأحكام، الأعلم بالقرآن أعلم. فاستدل لهم بهذا الأمر أنهم هم أعلم بتأويله، ثم قال وليس فيكم منهم أحد. فالصحابة رضي الله تعالى عنهم ما كان فيهم البدعة أبدا، وما حدثت إلا من بعدهم، ولكن حدثت في زمانهم من غيرهم حتى يبينوا ما أمرهم الله عز وجل بذلك ويجاهدوا في الله حق جهاده. والبدع التي ظهرت في زمن الصحابة من أعداء الدين رد الصحابة ذلك وبينوها ووضحوا أمرها، وكانوا أشد الناس على البدعة والمبتدعين. ومن اللطائف أيضاً ما يدل أيضا على على أن الكتاب والسنة وعلى أن الوحي جاء بمراعاة ما يتعلق بالعقل، أن يعني هذا من الأمور التي مررت عليه قريبا من كلام العلماء، على أن الحكمة أو لعل أن يكون هذا من الحكمة في أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يعرج به إلى السماء مباشرة من مكة إلى السماء، بل يعني ذهب إلى بيت المقدس حتى يسأل عن بيت المقدس، لأن كفار قريش كانوا يعرفون بيت المقدس ويعرفون أوصافه ولهم رحلة إليه، فجعل الله عز وجل وهم يعلمون أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما ذهب إلى بيت المقدس قط. فهذه من الأدلة العقلية التي يعني لو كانوا يعقلون لآمنوا، ولكنهم كابروا، وإلا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصف لهم بيت المقدس وهو ما ذهب إليه قط قبل ذلك، قد جاء في الحديث أنه رفع له فوصفه. فيا من صدقتم وآمنتم بوصفه لبيت المقدس، لماذا لا تؤمنون بعروجه إلى السماء؟ وكل ذلك من التأكيدات على صدق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وهذا فيها مراعاة أيضا أيضا لأفهامهم وإدراكهم، فجعل الله عز وجل أمورا قبل الإسراء في أو قبل المعراج، كل ذلك لزيادة إيمانهم أو إيمان الصحابة، وكذلك لعل أن هؤلاء يعني يرعون ويتركون ما هم فيه من المكابرة. فلذلك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصف بيت المقدس وصفا دقيقا، وصف يعني بيت المقدس وصفا دقيقا، وكل هذا يعني رحمة بالناس لعلهم يؤمنون، لعلهم يعني يكون هذا أمر يعني لأن يؤمنوا بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولكن من أراد الله عز وجل أن يهديه يشرح صدره الإسلام. نعم.
Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, when he went to debate with the Khawarij, he said to him, they said to him, where did you come from? And he said, I came from the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the side of the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was amongst them that the Quran was sent down, and they witnessed and attended the sending down of the Quran and the revelation of the verses and the ayat of the Quran, and they are the most knowledgeable of the Quran, because the one who witnessed and who was present when the verses came down and the reasons when the verses came down, why did they come down in the different occasions, they are the most knowledgeable of the Quran. And the one who is most knowledgeable of the Quran is the one who is most capable of understanding having the correct understanding and having the knowing the rulings that they can be extracted and understood from the Quran.
ولذلك يقال الراوي أدرى بمرويه. الراوي أدرى بمرويه. صاحب القصة أدرى بقصة من غيره.
This is why it is said that the one who narrates is most knowledgeable, or is considered to be more knowledgeable about that which he narrates. And the one whom the story is about is more knowledgeable than anyone else regarding that story. And so he, may Allah be pleased with him, he said to the Khawarij, and I see none of the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam amongst you. This is because the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, they were the first, the farthest away from innovations.
وهذا يا إخوان معذرة، لماذا قال لهم هذا الأمر وليس فيكم منه أحد؟ يعني يريد أن يبين لهم أنكم أبعد للحق، لأنه ليس معكم أحد من الصحابة أيضا. وهذا يعني شيء ينبغي أن يعقل، لم يكن أحد من الصحابة وحاشاهم مع الخوارج، يدل على أنهم أهل باطل، يدل على أنهم أهل باطل، لأن الصحابة رضي الله عنهم كثر، ولم يكن أحد من الخوارج أو لم يكن أحد من الصحابة من هؤلاء. هذا يدل أيضا يعني أنهم أهل باطل. لو كانوا أهل حق لكان معهم الصحابة رضي الله عنهم.
And why did he say, I see none of the companions from amongst you? Because as was established, that the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, are the most knowledgeable and are the people who are upon the truth. And they are many. The companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam are many, are great in numbers. And there's none of them, none of the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, with the Khawarij. And who is upon the truth and who is upon the falsehood? It is clear that the Khawarij are upon the falsehood. Because the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam are the ones who are upon the truth. The companions, may Allah be pleased with them, they had, none of them had any innovations. None of them innovated in the religion. None of them followed any innovations. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed that there will be innovations at their times so that we can see and learn how did they deal with the innovations and the people of innovation. How did they refute the innovators? How did they refute the innovations? How did they deal with them? How they were severe in regards to their refutation of the innovations and the people of innovation.
بل العلماء قالوا أمهات البدع حدثت في زمن الصحابة. أمهات البدع القدرية الخوارج المرجئة هؤلاء أمهات البدع حصلت في زمن الصحابة ليرد الصحابة عليهم ويكون يعني حجة لنا بكلام الصحابة فيهم ككلام ابن عمر وابن عباس وغيره من الصحابة.
Rather, the people of knowledge, they say that the foundations of all of the innovations happened at the time of the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, such as the Khawarij and the Murji'ah and Al-Qadariyah. All of those were at the time, they came out at the time of the companions, may Allah be pleased with them. So that the statements of the companions and the refutations of those innovations and the innovators who had them, that they are approved for us and against those who follow those innovations. And from the things that tell us that the Quran and the Sunnah come with agreement with the intellects is the wisdom, as the people of knowledge, our Shaykh Abdullah, he said that he recently came across this from the words of some of the people of knowledge, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the night journey and the ascension to the heavens, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made him go from the sacred house in Mecca to Jerusalem, al-Masjid al-Aqsa in Jerusalem, and then he took him in the ascension to the heavens. And there is a wisdom that the people acknowledge, that they said perhaps one of the reasons is that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would pass by, would come to Masjid al-Aqsa, so that the people would ask him about Masjid al-Aqsa. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was asked, so they asked him, if this is so, if you were taken on this journey, then describe Masjid al-Aqsa to us. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was brought forth to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam so that he would describe it to the people. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam described it to them. And then this is first of all a strengthening of the belief of the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, of the believers, that they saw and heard the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam describing the Masjid al-Aqsa, although he never went there. And the people at that time, and in the pre-Islamic era of ignorance, they used to travel to Al-Sham and Masjid al-Aqsa, and they used to see it. So the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam described it, although he had not seen it. And as for the polytheists and the disbelievers, that so that the proof is established against them, and if they had sound minds and sound intellects, they would come to realize that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is describing with details something that he had not seen. So if they truly had sound minds, then it is upon them to believe in what he said. But of course, it is whomso Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses for him to be guided, that he is guided, and whomso Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses for him to go astray, he goes astray.
كذلك مما يدل على أن الإسلام جاء للمحافظة على العقل أن تحريم المعاصي والمنكرات أنها تنافي الأخلاق الكريمة وأيضا العقول المستقيمة. فالعقول الصحيحة لا يعني لا ترد ذلك. جميع المعاصي التي نهى الله عنها وحذر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم منها لا تنافي العقول، بل العقول الصحيحة تردها وتبين بأنها معاصي. ولذلك انظروا الخمر، الخمر يذهب العقل، يذهب العقل الذي به إدراك، به الإدراك، وما جاء فيه من أنه أخبث أم الخبائث الخمر، لأنه يذهب العقل، وإذا ذهب العقل أصبح كالمجنون يفعل ما يشاء. والأصل يا إخوة أن الذي يفعل ما يشاء أنه مجنون، هذا الأصل، الذي يفعل ما يريد هو المجنون، والذي يفعل ما يريده الله منه هو العاقل. ولذلك كما أسلفنا أن بعض الناس يقول أنا أفعل ما أريد، أفعل ما أشاء، لا فرق بينه وبين المجنون لأنه يفعل ما يشاء. لكن الذي تجد أنه منضبط في كلامه في فعله فإن هذا عاقل، فإن هذا عاقل. جميع المعاصي وجميع الذنوب وجميع المنكرات العقول السليمة تمجها، والفطر المستقيمة تعلم أنها رذيلة وأنها سيئة. حتى إن أهل الجاهلية قبل الإسلام تجد أن لهم كلاما في بعض المعاصي التي حرمها الله عز وجل، وأنهم يمجونها، مثل قول يعني عنترة بن شداد يعني الذي هو قبل بعثة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، يعني له كلمات. لأن يا إخوة الدين، دين الإسلام جاء يعزز الفطرة التي فطر الله الخلق عليها والناس عليها. ولذلك هناك فطر كانت موجودة، إنما بعثت ليتمم مكارم الأخلاق. أنت ترى يقول وأغض طرفي إن بدت لي جارتي حتى يواري جارتي مأواها، ويقول يا عبل أين من المنية مهرب إن كان ربي في السماء قضاها. فيعني هذه أمور فطرية. هل هناك أحد من أهل العقول السليمة يقول أن الكذب شيء طيب، أن الكذب عياذا بالله شيء ترتاح له النفوس؟ الكذاب خائف، والكذاب عياذا بالله يعني تجده لا يتذكر الكذب. ولذلك كانوا يقولون إذا كنت كذوبا فكن ذكورا، فإن الكذب ينسى والصدق لا ينسى. الصدق ما ينسى أبدا، وأما الكذب ينسى، وينسى لأنه يعني ليس هو الحقيقة، لأن النفوس مفطورة على محبة الحق والعمل به. فلذلك جميع المعاصي يعني تردها العقول المستقيمة. فإذا جئت إلى شخص وذكرت له هذه المعاصي التي حرمها الله عز وجل، عقله السليم ينبغي أن يوافق ويقول لك نعم هذا سيء، الخمر سيء، الفواحش سيئة، الغيبة، النميمة، هذه كلها يعني تبعث البغضاء والشحناء والعداوة بين الناس. فما جاء الدين بما يخالف العقول، بل جاء الدين للمحافظة على العقول. ولذلك انظروا قال الله سبحانه وتعالى ومن يرغب عن ملة إبراهيم إلا من سفه نفسه. إلا من سفه، السفيه حاشاكم، السفيه هو الذي يرغب عن ملة إبراهيم. وملة إبراهيم ما هي؟ هي الدين الحق، هي توحيد الله عز وجل. إلا من سفه نفسه. فإذا ما الفرق؟ ما هو السفيه وما هو العاقل؟ من رغب عن ملة إبراهيم، هذا من يرغب عن ملة إبراهيم هذا السفيه. ومن تمسك بملة إبراهيم التي في